Happy Moed. Today is the middle of the Moed of Sukkot. This beautiful weather here. It's good to have you here. And in a way, today it's a special dedication, not only to a special yahrzeit. Today is the yahrzeit of the great Vilna Gaon, Rabbi Eliyahu ben Rabbi Shlomo Zalman, the great-great-grandfather of Larry. And
yes,
just some note from the Vilna Gaon. They said that on his behalf, on his famous statement, that each mitzvah in all the 613 commandments we are doing in one of our evarim, one of our body parts. Can be a mitzvah with the hands, with the ear, with the eyes, etc. It's only two mitzvot, the Vilna Gaon said, that apply to the entire body. And he said, one is the mitzvah that we are doing now, Yeshivat Sukkah, dwelling in a sukkah. Another one is the dwelling in Eretz Israel. And the pasuk that he support that point is Vayhi v'shalem suko u'me'onato b'tzion. The subject of today, it's Tractate Psachim, Tzadik Hei, page 95. And we're going to compare between the first Pesach and the second one, 14 day of month of Nisan to 14 day of month of Iyar. So the Mishnah gives us a list of the difference between Pesach Rishon and Pesach Sheni. Tosfot tells us that that's not the whole list. Other commented that, for example, the peace offering and other things are difference between the two Pesachim. But the key discussion is, what's the real difference between Pesach Rishon to Pesach Sheni? Kechukat haPesach yaaseh oto. The Torah said, according to the law of Pesach, they should do it. So, ma ben Pesach harishon lasheni? What's the difference between the first Pesach and the second? Harishon asur bebal yirae ubal yematze, vehasheni chametz umatza imo babayit. Simple. First one, the Torah tells us, you should not have anything with the chametz, new meat. The second one, you can have even lechatchila chametz umatza babayit. Another point, harishon ta'un amirat halel be'achilato, which is, while we are having the mitzvah of eating the Paschal lamb, we are saying full Hallel. Later the Gemara bring the source for that. The Rabbi Moshe ben Nachman, the Ramban said, in explained that the reason we are saying the Hallel, it's because this is the essence of being out of exile, of Mitzrayim, of slavery. והשני אינו טעון הלל באכילתו. The second one is not required to say הלל while they're eating it on 14 day of month of Iyar. Later, you see in the Talmud Yerushalmi and others, more differences. For example, the slaughtering process that they have at three different groups, the idea of 4 days, and the second one doesn't need the Bikur Abaye. Anyway, next, since we have those several differences between the first one and the second one, ze veze teunin halel ba'asiyatan. Now we go the other way around, and we show the mechanism between the first and the second halel, which means we have the obligation to read the Hallel while we are in the process of the ritual slaughtering of the Paschal lamb. And we do it at the same time, ve'ne'echalim tzali, and we need to roast them following the biblical precept, al matzah u'merorim, and the matzah and the bitter herb, ve'dochin et ha'shabbat, and they override Shabbat, in that they may be slaughtered and their blood sprinkled even on Shabbat, which is if Shabbat occurred on 14th of Nisan or Iyar, we still have this process of slaughtering and sprinkling. Tanu Rabbanan. Now we try to zoom in, mainly to focus first on the second time Pesach. Again, Book of Bamidbar, chapter 9. The sages teach us, Kechol chukat ha-Pesach ya'asu oto. The Torah said, they shall not leave none of it in the morning, nor break the bone in it. According to all the entire status of the Paschal lamb, they shall offer. So what we derive from that? B'mitzvah shebegufo hakatuv medaber. From the statement of ya'asu oto, we derive that mitzvah within the body of the Paschal lamb, we are speaking here, which means we don't speaking of the process, we don't speaking about eating it roasted, but we talking about mitzvah begufo, within the speaking of applicable to the body of the Paschal lamb, meaning that the halachot pertaining to the actual Paschal lamb on the first Pesach apply equally to the second, to the Paschal lamb on the second Pesach. Mitzvah she'al gufo minayin. From where do we learn that mitzvot that come with things that come along with the Paschal lamb, such as the mitzvah of eating the Pesach together with matzah and maror? Remember, we discuss it when we talk about Hillel and the sandwich. So that's part of the mitzvah of combining Pesach with matzah and maror. But it's like on the body of Pesach, Rashi said, because we have to combine it together. The Minchat Chinuch in mitzvah 17 elaborate on that. Anyway, so they said, Talmud lomar al matzot u'merorim yochluhu. They have to do it as a combination of bitter herb and matzah together. Yachol afilu mitzvot shelo al gufo. You may think that that's apply also to mitzvot that not at all related to the body of Paschal lamb, such as the requirement to destroy all the ones leaven. Talmud lomar ve'etzem lo yishberu bo. The Torah said, and they shall not break a bone. It is, that's basically chapter 9, Book of Numbers. Mash virata etzem yuchad mitzvah shebegufo, af kol mitzvah shebegufo. The same way as breaking the bone, it's mitzvah that applicable specifically to the Paschal lamb itself, so too any mitzvah applicable to the Paschal lamb itself must be fulfilled on the second Pesach. On the contrary, mitzvot, other mitzvot pertaining to the first Pesach, so you don't need to be fulfilled on the second Pesach. Isi ben Yehuda omer, you don't need to derive it from etzem lo yishberu bo, ya'asu oto mitzvot shebegufo hakatuv medaber. Because they use the term they shall perform it, that's an indication that the verse is speaking only on mitzvot applicable to the body of the Paschal lamb itself. So basically Isi ben Yehuda disagrees with Tanakama. According to him, you don't need these three mitzvot in order to learn this principle. It's enough to use the pasuk kechol chukat ha-pesach ya'asu oto in order to learn the whole principle. because he speaks only mitzvot that apply to the body of the Paschal lamb, apply also to the second one. But he have to add also mitzvot that made on the body of the Paschal lamb, because the Torah said clearly that you combine the second Pesach together with matzot and merorin. So soon Issa ben Yuna need to explain how we get to that. But anyway, Amar Mar, our master said, Yachol af mitzvah shelo al gufo. Maybe other mitzvot that not apply to the body of the Paschal lamb apply to the second Pesach. Ha'amar, you can say that you derive from the word Ya'asu oto, mitzvah shebegufo hakatuv medaber. The Torah speak the mitzvah that applicable to the body of the Paschal lamb. So they will not think that it's unrelated mitzvot also are included. So the Gemara responded and said, Hachei ke'amar, you derive from the word Ya'asu oto, hashta de'amart al matzot u'merorim yochlu, since you use the term, the pasuk, that you should eat a combination of matzah and bitter herb together, which means that this mitzvah that not made within the body of the Paschal lamb, alma ya'asu oto lav davkau. So it means that what we use in the Torah, the word they should do it, it's not necessarily applied to the body of Pesach, and so therefore it's like a principle. Oto is like a mi'ut, but you cannot say that it's a mi'ut in this sense, which means ya'asu oto is like a general principle that tells us that all the dinim of Pesach apply also to the second one. Hey, mahavelei kifrat uklal. Maybe it's a general principle and a specific. Remember, that's one of the 13 Sufim principle of Rabbi Ishmael. V'nasa klal mosif al haprat. And this is like a general principle that add to the specific without limitation. V'afilu kol milei namen, anything that apply to the second Pesach, even that it's a mitzvah that not made on the body of Pesach itself, like annulling any type of leaven, it's a, that's not that may apply to the second one, kamash melan. So the Torah teaches no, second Pesach not apply to leaven bran, because they said clearly that these three mitzvot that apply to the second Pesach, instead of saying one of them. So this psukim wants to teach us that this specific mitzvot that apply to the second Pesach in comparison to these three mitzvot, and that's the only one. Otherwise, we cannot derive this idea of klal uprat. Isi ben Yehuda ha'etzem maya vidle. So how does Isi ben Yehuda reply to that part that speaks about etzem, which is the very end? The Torah said, and they shall not break a bone in it. So he said, mi bayalei le'echad etzem sheyesh bo moach ve'echad etzem shein bo moach. So he needs it to teach the prohibition of breaking a bone applies both to a bone that has a marrow and the bone that does not have a marrow. So that's all incorporated with the prohibition of breaking the bone, which means even a bone that does not have a marrow, you cannot break it. That's the idea of fulfilling the mitzvah, ve'achlu et habasar balayla hazeh. Anyway, the big question that Tosfot also asks, Mitzpeh Etan deal with that, is how come they don't use the word lo yashiru mimenu ad boker, which is not left until the morning. Anyway, the tzlach, Rabbeinu Hanal explain it. So anyway, v'rabanan haya asu oto may avdei, how the sages, which means the Tanakama, that disagree with Isi ben Yehuda, explain oto, that's not come to reduce anything, but to teach us what they learn from the word Ya'asu oto mi bayalei שאין שוחטין את הפסח, which means that they don't slaughter the second Pesach על היחיד. For individual, the hama, לאפשר, דאפשר להדורי מהדרינה. So which means, if you have
changed,
if you have a person that he is impure, they are searching for another impure person to join him together on his Paschal lamb, in order to have at least two people. So therefore, Rashi said, you take someone who, for example, touch a creeping animal, and you combine with another fellow that have the same issue, and that you derive from the word in plural, ya'asu. Ya'asu, plural. Tanu Rabbanan. The Torah said in regard to Pesach Sheni, kechol chukat ha-Pesach ya'asu oto. That according to the entire status of the Paschal lamb, they should offer it. So, יכול כשם שהראשון עשו בבל יראה ובל ימצא, כך שני עשו בבל יראה ובל ימצא. תלמיד לומר, על מצות ומרורים יאכלו. May you think, the same way as the Torah prohibited by saying that it should not be in your meat, you should not find anyone in your place, and therefore it's applied to both the first and the second. So therefore we derive from an addition word on matzot and bitter herb they should eat. And therefore you have a general statement, and then you have kechol chukat ha-pesach yasu oto, which means that only those who similar, specific similar to that principle, which means only mitzvot that apply to the body of Paschal lamb itself apply to the second one, which is Bal Yireh u'Bal Yimatzeh, not apply to the second one. Ve'ein li ela mitzvat aseh, the obligation to eat the Pesach together with matzah and maror, it's a positive commandment. So therefore the prat u'klal, the specific and a general principle, apply to ribui and mi'ut, to add and subtract, only other positive commandment. Soon the Gemara gives us a list of. So they said, "Bemitzvat mitzvat lo ta'ase minayin." How do you know it's an application to a negative commandment? Talmud lomar lo yashiru mimenu ad boker. They should not leave anything from that until the morning. And then you have the general principle that said, general statement that we just mentioned, to go and derive negative commandment. So from that we derive that the prohibition of Bal Yireh and Bal Yimatzeh, Rashi said, does not apply to the second Pesach, because it's called lav hanitak le'aseh, like lo yashiru mimenu ad boker. Anyway, so he said, ואין לי מצוות לא תעשה גמור מניין. But if you tell me that that's total a negative commandment, how you derive it? תלמוד לומר, ועצם לא ישברו בו. The verse said, they shall not break the bone on it. It may be concluded from these examples that it's applied ma הפרט מפורש, just as the detail, which is the specific mitzvot mentioned in these verses, so it's applied to them, mitzvot aseh, it's a explicit and includes a positive commandment, ולא תעשה, and negative commandment prohibited, whose violation is, can be rectified, שניתק לעשה, by fulfilling a positive commandment, ולא תעשה גמור, and a full-fledged negative mitzvah. אף כל מצוות עשה, the same manner is every positive commandment, ולא תעשה, and every prohibition whose violation can be rectified by the fulfillment of positive mitzvah, שניתק לעשה,
ולא תעשה גם הוא, and every full-fledged negative mitzvah in included, and it's all derived from that point that goes to ribui miut to Pesach Sheni. So, when we are dealing with these three mitzvot, one positive, one negative that nitak le'aseh, and one total negative, prohibitive. And then you see the general principle, the Torah tells us that in regards to all different mitzvot, we derive specific mitzvot only for Pesach Sheni, and not all the mitzvot of the Pesach one. Bichlalei de matzot u'merorim ma'ika merabei. So, in what is included through the generalization of unleavened bread and bitter herb, kamerabei tzli esh, which is the roasting of the fire of the Pesach. So that's mitzvat aseh, positive commandment that apply also to second Pesach. Bifratei mai kamemaitle, what is excluded to the details, hashbatat seor, removal of leaven, that's not applied to second Pesach. So the Gemara asks, ipu chana, we should do it the other way around, which means a mitzvah relating to the Pesach lamb itself is preferable. It's more reasonable to assume that the first and the second Pesach are comparable to that. So they said mitzvah degufei adif, that mitzvah of the itself is better. So you better going with the tzli esh, with the roast in the fire, that's applied to the body of Pesach lamb itself, and take out the mitzvah that it's not by the body itself, like annulling any type of leavened bread. Second, bichlalei, in a general principle, the lo yashiru memenu ad boker, that they should not leave none to the morning. So that's applied to what? Lo totzi mimenu, you shall not remove any of it. So what is the prohibition of taking out meat of Pesach lamb out of the house, that even you do by returning the meat inside the house and fulfilling the positive mitzvah of eating there, and that's derived from what the Torah said, bebayit echad ye'achel, you should eat it in one house, lo totzi min habayit min habasar chutz, you should not take it out of the house. So bifratei ma'ika me'maitle, in a specific, what is the exclude through the details, lo yirae velo yimatze, he should not seen, he should not found, which in a way it's very similar to it. Now, so he said that's the case, mitzvah degufei adif, mitzvah with the body itself is better, because otherwise the love of taking out of the Pesach lamb, it's like part of the Pesach lamb, like it's a full-fledged. But the other one, Bali Ra'eh Bali Matzeh, it's not a full-fledged. So they said, Bichlalei, now we go to the third one, Bichlalei de Etzem Lot Yishberu Bo, with a, through the generalization, they should not break the bone in it. Tzadikei Amud Bet, Mai Kamerabei, what is it including, beyond what is mentioned explicitly in the verse, we derive from that, al tochlu mimenu na, do not eat it from it raw. So it said, bifratei maika memaete, so what you exclude to its details, lo tishchat al chametz dam zivchi, the Torah said there, in the book of Exodus chapter 34, you shall not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leavened bread. So they said again, ipuchana, you should go and reverse it and say the opposite, the prohibition against eating offering raw is excluded. The prohibited oil of laden is included. So mitzvah di gufei hadid, the mitzvah related to peskelem itself is preferable. So therefore, the negative mitzvah of slaughtering the peskelem on the chametz, it's mitzvah not making on the body of peskelem itself. That's what Rashi said. The Sfat Emet asks, so how come that's not applied to a second Pesach? And he answered. Anyway, the Mishnah said, "Harishon ta'ul alel b'achilato." We said in the Mishnah that in the first Pesach required to recite the Hallel as it's eaten. So they said, "Menanim ile." How do you know? Amar Rabbi Yochanan mishum Rabbi Shimon ben Yotzadak. Amar Kra, he brought a sentence from the book of Yeshaya, Isaiah 30. Hashir yelachem kelel hitkadesh hachag. So he speaks, Isaiah speaks about the day that Am Israel in Mitzvah Shem will be redeemed from the galut, from the exile. And he said, this will be the same celebration of the eve of the festival. So so Rashi goes and explains that the pasuk, the sentence juxtaposed that to the original redemption of Egypt to the future one. Anyway, we derive from that Laila Hamekudash Lachag, special night that dedicated for the Chag, which is the first night of Pesach. Ein Taun Alel. So you have this prohibition of doing work. So it's like you don't sell it, but the second one is not sanctified, so it's not a festival, so you don't have any prohibition of doing work, etc. Now, the difference between the first one and the second one, that we talk about Hallel, second one doesn't need to have Hallel, it's applied to Hallel while you eating the Pesach, but not at the time you are
preparing it,
slaughtering. Ze vaze tounin alel ba'asiyatan ma'itama. Iba'et teima laila kamemayet yom, yom lo kamemayet laila. One option is you go by saying that the night when the festival is sanctified excludes laws that apply at night, but it's not excludes law that apply by the day. And if you wish, you say that halacha simply made logical sense. Libay teima, efshar Yisrael shochatim b'shem lo'avim l'vem v'lomrim alel. As we said in Gemara, in the page 117 here, it's possible that we are slaughtering the Paschal lamb, taking the lavim on Sukkot, and not reciting alel. It's impossible. So therefore, there's no need to explicit the biblical source for this halacha. Then the Mishnah said, "Venechalin tzali," both of them eating roasted on matzah and merurim, and the override Shabbat. So they said, "Shabbat ein tum'a lo." You tell me that that applies solely for Shabbat. Yes, it's overridden by Paschal lamb, but the ritual impurity now it's not overridden. So he said, "Matnitin delo k'Rabbi Yehuda." So if that's the case, Mishnah is not teach us according to Rabbi Yehuda. The Tanya, in regard to second Pesach, Dochet et HaShabbat ven Dochet et HaTumah. They said that it's override Shabbat, but not ritual impurity. Rabbi Yehuda Omer, Av Dochet et HaTumah. Rabbi Yehuda said, well, it overrides even a ritual impurity. Mai Tana Ma, the Tana Kama. What's the reason of the Tana Kama, the first Tana? מפני תומעד חיטיב יחזור ויעשה בתומה. So because they have a ritual impurity, I basically postponed it, rejected it, to what? To the second Pesach. So can you tell me that it's come back and do the second one in the ritual impurity? So he was impure at the first one, and the reason for that was enough to postpone it to the second one, in order to make him the second Pesach while he's in a state of ritual impurity. So he cannot tell me that the person can bring the second Pesach while he's in a ritual impurity. So he said, Rab Yehuda, Rab Yehuda hold, HaTorah chazra alav la'asoto betara. The Torah go after to make sure that that you perform it while is a ritual purity. Lo zacha, if he is not married to doing it, so yaser betuma, at least let him perform it the second Pesach while in a state of ritual impurity. Tanu Rabbanan. Rabbis teach us Pesach Rishon dochet Shabbat, Pesach Shni dochet Shabbat. Both of them override Shabbat. Pesach Rishon dochet Tumah, Pesach Shni dochet Tumah. Both of them override ritual impurity. Pesach Rishon ta'ul lina, Pesach Shni ta'ul lina. The first and the second one require that you're remaining until the morning. So even the morning rise, he cannot return to his house because he needs to stay close to Yerushalayim in order to be part, to be seen in the Beit HaMikdash and bring Olat Riya, offering for sin. Had everyone obligated each one of the three festivals. Anyway, דוחה את התאומה כמן כרב יהודה ורב יהודה טעון לינה. So he tell me that if it's a ritual impurity, it's go by Rabbi Yehuda. The whole that second Pesach override the ritual impurity. So it said, according to Rabbi Yehuda, the second Pesach, you need to have it overnight. So it said, V'hatanya, Rabbi Yehuda Omer. We learned that Rabbi Yehuda said, Minay le Pesach Shni Shein Taun Lina. How do you know that the second Pesach not required to remain until morning? So they said, Shenemar, the Torah said in Book of Devarim, Deuteronomy 16, Ufanita vaboker vaalachta lo alecha, and you shall turn in the morning and go to your tent. Uchtiv, shesh yamim tochal matzot, mark after that said 6 days you should eat matzot. So we derive from that, because they are attached to each other, anecha leshlishisha, only the first Pesach, that matzah was eaten there 6 days, ta'un lina, need to remain, require remaining until morning. She'en ne'echa le'shisha, if it's not required to eat matzah for 6 days, eino ta'un lina, it's not required remaining until morning. This contradicts previously stated, citing Rabbi Yehuda. So they said, Trei Tanae Valibad Rabbi Yehuda. This statement was made by two Tanaim, according to opinion of Rabbi Yehuda, but the two Tanaim disagree what happened to the one is have the requirement to stay overnight on the second Pesach. Before the Mishnah, just introduction, as we said earlier, when most of the people are not pure at the 14th day of Nisan, so by force of circumstance, they can go ahead and bring the Paschal lamb while they are not in a state of purity, and it's override all these prohibitions that should not enter the temple courtyard, doing work there, eating a consecrated item in the ritual impurity. But the Mishnah circumscribed, limited this point, and they said, HaPesach Sheba Betum'ah, if there is a situation that Paschal and come with the state of ritual impurity, Lo Yochlu Mimeno Zavin Zavot Nidot V'Yoldot. People like Zav, discharge, male, female, Nida, and women, the child, etc. All of this, they are part of the register of the Korban, but Ve'im Achlu, Pturim Mikaret, but if they ate, they exempt from Karet, for someone who ate consecrated item while he's not pure. But as far as the entering the Beit HaMikdash while the impurity, that's they're not exempt from Karet. Rabbi Lezer Poter Afal Biat Mikdash, he even exam that entered the Mikdash while the state of impurity exam. He said that that's punishment not apply when they bring the Paschal lamb and ritual impurity. He said it's not. Later the Gemara bring the source for that. Anyway, the Sfat Emet have a beautiful point here. Anyway, Tanu Rabbanan, Zavim veZavot Nidot veYoldot Sheachlu bePesach Sheba beTumah. If it happens they ate from Pesach that come from ritual impurity, Yachol Yehu Chayavim. Maybe they deserve karet for eating a consecrated item. Talmud Lomar, we derive from the Torah, Book of Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 7, Kol Tahor Yochal Basar. Any pure person can eat the meat from the peace offering. והנפש אשר תאכל מבשר בשר מזבח השלמים אשר להשם ותומתה עליו נכרתה. But any soul that eat meat from that peace offering that belong to Hashem and they carry ritual impurity, that soul should be cut. So because the Torah put together these two psukim, one next to the other, we derive that only in a situation of consecrated meat, ne'echalat horim, chayavin alav, mishum tameh, that they deserve karet because eating consecrated item while they are ritually impure, ve'she'eino ne'echalat horim, but the consecrated item that not eaten by the pure, like paschal lamb that come with ritual impurity, and tmeim, those who ritually impure, like zav, metzora, etc., chayavim alav mishum tameh, they don't deserve karet for eating consecrated item while it's ritually impure. V'Rabbi Eliezer, remember we said earlier in the Mishnah that Rabbi Eliezer have a source, he said, yachol dachaku zavim umtzorim nechsu la'azara, mebezach abaduma, maybe they push and they enter to the azara while they're ritually impure. So he said, Talmud Lomar, the Torah said in Bamidbar, in Book of Numbers, chapter 5, Vayishalchu min ha-machane kol tzarua v'chol zav v'chol tmeh la-nefesh. They derive from the out from the machane, from the camp, anyone who's a leper, discharge, etc. So because we put together in a connection of the sentences between someone who touched a corpse to someone of a discharge or leper, we derive bizman shtemei metim mishtalchin zavin umetzoraim mishtalchin ein tmei metim mishtalchin ein zavin umetzoraim mishtalchin. That's apply as long as all the others, but like Pesach that come with ritual impurity, but otherwise they not. Bae Rav Yosef. So Rav Yosef challenges and said, "Dachakut me'ei metim v'nichesu la'echal," which means there is an area that even Kohanim, Rashi said, not allowed to enter if it's not totally necessary. Just word of explanation: inside the temple, the Beit HaMikdash, it was a different sections. It was the basically three sections. One, it's called the Ulam, which is the big area like
the
a hall.
Big courtyard, yeah.
Hall. And then it was Ha-Heichal, the sanctuary, and then it was Kodesh HaKodashim, Holy of Holies. So each one of them carry a different level of sanctuary, but the sanctuary has carry more than the courtyard. So even the Kohanim can go in a courtyard, but entering the sanctuary not allow only for the purpose of Avodah, of doing some work they have to. Because the Torah said after the crisis with Aaron's sons, Hashem said to Moshe Rabbeinu, tell your brother Aaron, ve'al yavo bechol et el ha-kodesh. You shouldn't go there all the time. And the Gemara said in Menachot 27 that specified the certain time that they allowed to do basically basic work. So bepesach haba v'tumah, if they basically push and they enter the sanctuary while they are ritually impure, mahu, they deserve karet or not? Midi ishtre tumat ez azara ishtre na metumat eichal odil mamai de ishtre ishtre mai lo ishtre lo ishtre. You say that because we allow ritual impurity in the courtyard, it may apply also to the sanctuary, or you said no. Whatever you are permitted, permitted. Whatever is not permitted, is not permitted. And consequently, they are liable for entering the sanctuary. So Rava responds, Amar Rava, Amar Kra, They said in there in Bamidbar chapter 5, וישלחו מן המחנה כל צרוע וכל זב, אפילו למקצת מחנה, even part of the camp. So the majority of Jewish people are ritually impure, even though people are ritually impure, are permitted to enter part of the Beit HaMikdash. איקרא דאמרי, it's another option, אמרה ואמר קרא וישלחו מן המחנה כל צרוע אל מחוץ למחנה תשלחון, כל אחד יקרין בר אל מחוץ למחנה תשלחון, קרין בר וישלחו מן המחנה. Whatever we call that they must send out from the camp, that's also applied to that, so which means that the, if the majority of the Jewish people are impure and the offering is sacrificed in a state of impurity, those who are impure are not liable if they enter to the sanctuary. So by Rav Yosef, dachakut ve'imitim, those who are ritually impure because touching the corpse, and they push ve'achlu imurei pesach ha'vavetumah, and they eat the fatal from the Pesachalim that offer in a state of ritual impurity. Mahu, what's the halakha? The liable of karet because they ate a consecrated item or ritual impurity or not? So they said, Mish, the ishteri, tumat basar, ishteri nami, tumat imurim, because you allow the ritual impurity of a meat, you allow also ritual impurity of the imurim, those sacrificial portion other than that, or dilma man the ishtri, ishtri man lo ishtri, the same, mahalach, amarav amich de tumat imurim meecha itra, bemitumat basar, we derive it from tumat basar, because we extended the prohibition of eating besar kodshim, a consecrated item, when it's ritual impurity, impure, dechtiv, the Torah said in Leviticus chapter 7, asher la Hashem, lerabot et ha'imurim, it said for Hashem, that included the sacrificial portion, and established that one is liable to receive karet, for eating this portion in a state of ritual impurity. So, kol heichad leit leitumat basar, leit leitumat imurim. By Rav Zera. So now we talk about imurim of Pesach. It said, imure Pesach mitzrayim lecha k'terinu. Those imurim, those portions of the Paschal lamb that the Jewish people sacrificed in Egypt, on the first Pesach, just before the left Egypt, what did they burn them? So he said, because they don't say there that they build the altar in order to bring that offering. Amar le Abaye, man le madlan lo shviski avud, shviskei avud. Who told that they don't use it roasted like they use nowadays the shipudim? So it's not a special commandment to Avod. V'atan Rav Yosef shlosha mizbechot ayu sham. They have three altars to sprinkle the blood in Egypt. But they put the blood of the Paschal lamb ala mashkof on the doorpost of their home, ve'al shtem zuzot in both sides, ve'tu miliachin ala ava. And then there was nothing else. So what we derive from that? That the Jewish people did not fulfill any mitzvah not explicitly mentioned in the Torah. So since we don't have other options, so you can come to conclusion that they did not offer the fats and other sacrificial portion on the altar. Usually the blood is come on that mizbeach, on the altar. But Chatam Sofer explained that this braita called the doorposts, mm-hmm. you know, the both side of the doorpost, they call it like mizbeach, like an altar, but not in a real manner of altar. It's called derech melitza. It's like some type of, I don't like to use the word joking, but it's like some type of just to make a statement, but it's the truth. They do not have, Chatam Sofer said, any type of mizbeach, any type of altar. So the day for it's not any matnot dam, any type of giving the blood is part of the ritual, and it wasn't haktarat imurim. So he said that the time of the original Pesach in Egypt, it wasn't real act of offering. It was just a general offering, but it wasn't the way that perceive it later on as part of the ritual of Pesach night. First halacha is Rambam, Sefer Korbanot, Ilchot Korban, Pesach, chapter 10. There are number of differences between the first and the second Pesach. On the first Pesach, the Rambam said, it is prohibited to own leaven, and the Paschal lamb may not be slaughtered while one is in possession of leaven. However, on the second Pesach, one may have both leaven and matzah together in one's house. Meat from the Paschal lamb on the first Pesach may not be taken outside of the area of the group who share the, and it has to be eaten just place and not in the other group. And there is a requirement to recite Hallel while eating the sacrifice. In contrast, meat from the Paschal lamb on the second Pesach may be taken outside the area of the group who share it or be eaten with another group. And there is no requirement to recite Hallel while eating it. In addition, Shlamim, a festival peace offering, is brought with the Paschal lamb on the first Pesach, but not on the second. Furthermore, on the first Pesach, the offering may be consumed in a state of ritual impurity if the majority of the community is ritually impure. But on the second Pesach, the offering is neither sacrificed nor eaten in a state of ritual impurity. There is also a number of common elements between the first and the second Pesach. The slaughter of the offering overrides Shabbat. One is obligated to recite Hallel during the slaughter of the offering, and the offering must be roasted on a fire and eaten with matzah and bitter herb. Now, Rambam continue in Ilchot Korban Pesach and also said it in chapter 2, a Paschal lamb slaughter or for an individual is valid, however, every effort is made not to do so lechatchila. Negative mitzvot that apply to the Pesach lamb sacrificed on the first Pesach, such as the prohibition against breaking a bone from the offering, eating it raw, or leaving it meat uneaten until morning, all apply to the Paschal lamb on the second Pesach. And that's, again, Rambam Ilchot Korban Pesach, chapter 10. Now, what does the second Pesach override? The slaughter of the sacrificial services of the second Pesach override the halachot of Shabbat, just as they do on the first Pesach. However, the second Pesach does not override the halachot of ritual impurity. The Rambam also said that in regards to a people who are impure due to ritual impurity imparted by a corpse who entered the sanctuary, so he said in a case of a Pesach lamb sacrifice, when the majority of the Jewish people are in a state of ritual impurity, if people who are impure due to a ritual impurity imparted by a corpse enter the sanctuary, they are exempt from karet. That's the according to Rava's second answer, but the Rambam ruled leniently because in a case of doubt they cannot be liable to karet. And that again is the Kesef Mishnah on the Rambam, Hilchot Beit HaMikdash, chapter 4, halakha 13.